Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this opportunity, Lord God. We thank you for the fellowship of the saints that are here today, Lord God. We thank you for the saints who weren't able to make it. Lord God, that you be with them, Heavenly Father. Lord God, we just thank you for the word that's going forth today. We thank you for the pastor that you've placed before us, the shepherd that you've placed before us to lead this flock, Lord God. We ask that you give them revelation, knowledge, wisdom, understanding of your word. We ask that you give us the same revelation, knowledge, wisdom, and understanding of your word. The eyes of our understanding be enlightened today, Heavenly Father. That good seed goes forth, Heavenly Father, and that it falls on good ground. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that it is falling on good ground. That we take the word, the seed that's given today, that we go home and we study, Heavenly Father. That you would give us increase, Lord God, in wisdom and revelation, Lord God. So we thank you for it this day. We rejoice knowing, Heavenly Father, that we are, Heavenly Father, the promise that you set forth, Heavenly Father, in our communities and our households, Heavenly Father, as an example, Heavenly Father, of your kingdom. So we give you alone all the glory, honor, and praise for this day, in Jesus' name. And all in agreement with this prayer said, amen.
Amen. Show the importance of us acting in love, ministering to others. Kind of a summary, just go over that. So those of you that want to preach and teach, you can get in a whole lot of information that we share. As it tells the importance of ministering and different areas of ministry, the things that you can do to build each other, to edify, to encourage, to strengthen each other. It's actually a study in love. How to develop love. And we mentioned about 2 Peter, those seven virtues add to what we need to add to our faith. First thing it says, add to your faith, 2 Peter 1. And actually, this course is going to be covering all of those things that we need to add to our faith. So you can work out your lessons, take a holiness lesson, purity, moral purity. That will be the next lesson. And all of the virtues that's mentioned in 2 Peter 1, you're going to find those lessons in the book that you have, The Path to Success and Greatness. But I wanted to, last two or three weeks, I talked about the redemptive work of Christ. And so a knowledge of Christ's redemption is going to be the key to actually experiencing and being able to act in love. So faith worketh by what? But I think it's important for us to have a revelation of what Christ has done for us. Gospel, anybody can give us a definition of what the gospel is?
Good news.
Yes. Right? The gospel is good news. It's what? Come with God. Unto salvation.
Yes.
To everyone that what?
He believes.
So everything in the Word of God hinges around the gospel, what Jesus did. Once you can get a revelation of that and really understand the key components of Christ's redemption, you will be forehead when it comes to sharing Christ and ministering, particularly with grace in the ministry of reconciliation. Right, so I really like the, what it says in 2 Peter, add to your faith virtue knowledge. Knowledge is going to, revelation knowledge is going to come as a result of you really understanding what Christ actually did for us over 2,000 years ago, and also what Christ is actually doing for us in the now. How many understand the present day ministry of Christ? It wasn't over when Christ rose from the dead. Right? When Christ rose from the dead, is that it?
No.
All right, what happened after Christ rose from the dead? What did he do?
His ministry afterward, then he ascended to heaven.
Right?
Right.
When he took his blood into the Holy of Holies, that sealed our redemption. He sat down, right?
Yes.
He sat down, okay? So he entered into his rest. Where is Christ now?
Between us.
He's at the what?
Right at the
Father. All right. Is he a man or is he a union of God in there? What is he? All right. What is Christ now in his present state? What is he? Is he a man or is he God? Or
he's equal with God.
He is equal with God.
He is.
Well, I don't know how you want to put that, Pastor.
It's on the right hand of God.
He's glorified.
He's glorified.
Yeah. All right, so he's a man. The Bible says he's the only, he's our mediator between what? God and man. The man, right?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. So he's a man at the right hand of God. He's the only man in heaven, is that right?
Glorified,
you say?
Yes. Yes.
All right. So that's important because his ministry in heaven now determines our effectiveness and our productivity now as believers. So if we get a good revelation of what he has done to the time that he went to the cross until the time that he sat down at the right hand, then a revelation of that will enable you to be able to be his workmanship. Because during that 3-day period, he's the one that created us in what? In righteousness and true holiness. He recreated us. That's the time that he perfected forever those that are sanctified. He obtain eternal redemption for us. And boy, I tell you, if we really understand what Christ has done for us, everybody would just rejoice and shout and dance. Amen. You'll be full of joy, full of life. How many can say amen?
Amen.
We might have what? Life.
Yes.
We might have what? Life.
Life.
Now, I want to challenge you in this respect. Is that the name of Jesus has all of the power and authority in it because of what Jesus achieved during his redemptive work, what he achieved. Okay, all of the glories and honors and all of the praises and things that we give to that name, attach to that name, it's because of what Jesus did. It was his achievements. It was the things that he accomplished during his redemptive work. So you want to understand his achievements that he made, the things that makes him so great, the things that makes him so wonderful, the things that give him the name above all names. The reason why we pray in the name, the reason why we demand things to be done in the name, is because of what Jesus has done for us during the 3-day and 3-night period that we actually obtained eternal redemption through grace. So I want you to understand the scriptures and be able to recall and to articulate scripture that deals with the things that Jesus accomplished for us during that 3-day period. There are scriptures that will
actually explain exactly what Jesus, and when these scriptures actually become real to you, then you're going to have a lot more joy. How many want more joy?
Hey, I do.
How many want more victory?
Yeah.
Spiritually.
Yeah.
Financially.
Yeah.
It applies to every gram of our life, what Christ has done. So you want to know, understand exactly what happened when Christ became sin for us. That was a serious matter. When he became sin for us, you actually want to get a revelation of what happened and how that affects us, because in every aspect of Christ's redemption, it relates to us in some way. We identify with him in every aspect of his redemptive work. Every aspect of his redemptive work, we identify with him. When he became sin for us, amen, it was just like we were there, going through the same thing that Christ went through, because we suffered with him. Is that right? We died with him. We were crucified with him, and we were buried with him, and we were raised with him. So I want you to open your Bibles, because I think that these are things that we don't value enough. If the redemptive work of Christ is not, if it's not meaningful, if it's something that we treat lightly, then that means that what? Our spiritual dimension will be what? Very shallow too.
Yeah.
So we want to understand exactly the depth of his love and how much Christ suffered for us and the price that he paid, and how, if we can actually get a revelation of what Christ has done for us, it will really put the fear of God into our soul. Okay, I want somebody to tell me one scripture that deals with Christ becoming sin. You should be able to recall it, articulate it, or give a little bit of it. All right?
2 Corinthians 5:21.
All right, okay. Now, the scriptures that deal with Christ's atonement, him becomes the propitiation for our sins, him becoming sin for us, these are the scriptures that are going to be more meaningful. Okay, now, Christ becoming sin for us, atoning for us, we have a substitute. That's a major aspect of our redemption. All right, the other aspect of our redemption, which is very important, is the part that deals with Christ being quickened, Christ made alive, Christ being born out of death. Anybody understand what I'm talking about? That scripture says, this day, you know, God said this to his son, this day have I what? Begotten him. And sometimes people take that to mean that that was the day that he was what? Begotten physically. In the womb of Mary, you know. But that wasn't applying to when Mary conceived Jesus by the Holy Ghost. That speaks about his spiritual death. So we want to have understanding of Christ being made alive, or Christ being quickened, Christ begotten from the dead. The Bible mentioned that his soul, he would not suffer his Holy One to experience corruption. So he didn't actually, he stayed in the pit, the place of damnation, but the Bible says that God said he wouldn't suffer his body to suffer what? Corruption. It was only for a period of time till he endured our what? Our griefs and pains and bore our sins. Okay, so we want to kind of rightly divide these scriptures, because I think that these scriptures are worthy of meditation. I think anything that pertains to Christ's redemptive work is worthy of our meditation, because this is the theme, these are the scriptures that carry the most weight because we identify with Christ in every aspect of our redemption, of his redemptive work. We identify with him. In other words, in the mind of God, it was just like you being there in person. So, in the mind of God, everything that Christ did redemptively, it took place those 3 days in the mind of God. Now, actually, in reality, what Christ did for us doesn't become real to us until we what? We accept the redemptive work of Christ. We have to what? Receive Christ. Right? And the mind of God is already what? Done. Is that right? It was accomplished. The price was what? Paid in full. Jesus became sin for us, right? And we know all of the suffering that followed that. And we are speaking about spiritual sufferings that followed that. All right? Now, I believe somebody have given me one scripture that kind of explained Christ's him being our substitute. All right? That was 2 Corinthians what?
5:21.
All right, I want y'all to give me another one. Okay, what does 2 Corinthians 5:21 say?
For he had made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him.
All right, everybody together, we have we together, we have what?
We have
he had made him to be sin for us who knew no sin.
Alright, is our righteousness reckoned to us, or are we actually made the righteousness of Christ?
Made.
Alright, are you made the righteousness of Christ? When you are you are reckoned righteous before you're made righteous?
Yes, you're reckoned righteous before you're made righteous.
Right. I don't know what we're talking about.
Well, that's the pretty thought of saying that when God, when Christ created that, God already preordained that.
Right. All the process of our redemption work, he was paid for before actually we would experience it in reality, right? The work for our redemption was accomplished about what, 2,000 years ago. But yet, how many just got been saved 20 years? 15 or 20. Okay, it became reality to you the day that you received, you accepted what? Jesus Christ as your what?
Lord
and Savior. It became what? Reality. So there's a legal aspect of our redemption, and then there's a what? A vital aspect. The legal aspect is all that Christ did for us. And a lot of these scriptures that we're reading about, it talks about the legal aspect of our redemption. But when we accept what Christ has done, when we accept him as Lord and Savior, and you know, all we have to do, you know, that's the reason why Jesus sat down. He was able to become our what? Lord and Savior. And he was able to become our mediator. After he had what? After he had what? Completed the redemptive work. He was able to what? Sit down. Now, today, he's our what? Savior.
Yes.
But before he paid the price for our redemption, there was no way to get saved. Is that right?
Right.
All right. So he had to become, when man sinned, the greatest need that man had was eternal life, right?
Yeah.
He had to be what? Restored back to what? Life. That was man's greatest need. Everybody said man's greatest need.
Man's greatest need
is eternal life.
Eternal life.
Okay. But God can't grant eternal life until men become what? Righteous. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Somebody had to pay the price for man to be what? Made righteous. And who paid that price?
Jesus.
Okay. Now when Jesus paid the price for man to become righteous, then he was able to be man's what? Mediator. Mm-hmm. So the three greatest needs of mankind, number one is what? Eternal life. Number two is what?
A need of a mediator.
Okay, righteousness, right? Mm-hmm. And then what?
Mediator.
Mm-hmm. And Jesus actually what? Amen. He came that we might have what?
Life
and have what?
More
life more abundantly. Amen. So we want to
understand how important the role that Jesus played, how important it is for us. We need to learn these scriptures by memory. Are we too old? Because I'm a man, and it's so bad. We've used them so much. And we just can't remember no more. All right, 2 Corinthians 5:21, what does that say?
No sin for us.
All right, now, no sin. Let's be honest now. This is between me and y'all in the gate. How many have never heard that scripture before? I know you've heard that, no sacrifice and sin. But how many haven't taken time to what? To meditate that? All right? If you haven't taken time to meditate that, more than likely, the redemptive work of Christ is not going to be that meaningful to you. Okay, I'm going to give you another scripture, too. Hebrews 2, 14 and 15. I want you to just turn to those scriptures. Those scriptures are very important, too, because they deal with Christ being made sin for us. And because the scripture mentions he tasted death for what? Every man. Every man, he tasted what? Death. Amen. And he's the one that not only tasted death, but he what? Abolished death. Right? And he's the one that brought to light, L-I-G-H-T, life and immortality. That's really important. It might sound like it's something that doesn't relate to you, but when you begin to meditate these things, it's going to add a new dimension of strength to your life, okay? Hebrews 2:14. I'm going to go over these scriptures because I think that many times we kind of leave it up to you to meditate on your own, and many times we just don't, you know, get to it like we should. Hebrews 2:14, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. All right, okay, let's read that again. Everybody together. Or as much then as the
children.
He also
himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil.
Okay, 15, let's read together. And
what?
Subject to bondage. Okay, so Jesus had to become a union of what? God and man.
Mm-hmm.
He was already God, right?
Yes.
But he had to what? Come in the form of what? In the likeness of what? Man. He had to be 100% God, and he had to be what? 100% who?
Man.
Otherwise, he wouldn't have been able to atone for our sin. Is that right?
Yes.
Couldn't a regular man atone for us?
No.
Sin.
Sin.
All right, because what?
Sin.
All of sin and what?
Sure.
All right, okay, so man wouldn't have been able to qualify as our Redeemer because he was what? Tainted. In other words, he's the seed of what? Man or woman?
Adam.
He's the seed of what?
Man.
All right, okay. Man is the seed of what? Man. So every person that have been born since Adam have been what?
Sin.
They have been what? Tainted by sin. That sin, seed of sin has been what? Handed down to the entire human race. All of sin and what comes from all of the sin and what happened. Right? Okay, so Jesus had to be born independent of what? The human generation, right? He had to be born. So that's the reason why his birth was what? Miraculous, yeah. All right, so he was born what? From the seed of what? Woman. Right? He was impregnated by who?
Holy Spirit.
By who?
Holy Holy Spirit.
By the Holy Spirit. Y'all never heard that before? Anybody else you heard about being impregnated by the Holy Spirit? So I'm putting it on the Holy Ghost. Oh, praise God. Hallelujah. So, Jesus was God and man, and that was the reason why he was able to atone for our sins. But yet, he had to walk perfectly pleasing before God during the period of time that he was on the earth. If he had faltered, if he had followed in Adam's steps, if he had made one trip of a mistake, he wouldn't have qualified. Okay, you know, isn't that amazing that God is so smart? The Bible says the gospel is the power of God and the wisdom of God. The gospel, you know, how God actually redeemed the human race. You know, how he went about it. He was just to himself, he was just to Satan, and he was just to who? To man. So he respected man's, he respected what? Satan. He didn't take advantage. You know, he actually could have just said what? When Satan sinned, I mean, when Satan caused Adam to sin, he could have what, just taken Satan and just what? Threw him in the pit, I guess, then. But he wanted, because he wanted to be fair, because the dominion that Adam received from man through disobedience, he got it legally, right? He got it legally. I mean, Adam relinquished that on his own free will, right? Nobody forced them to. So therefore, he got it legally, so therefore God had to retrieve it on also what, a legal basis. That's the reason why he went about all this way around and did all of these processes. It was because God had to be fair with what? Satan had to be fair with what? Himself. He could have gone against his own what? His own holiness, and he had to be fair to the human race. Because actually man was made, he was made at a free what?
Moral
agent. So God made him with the ability to what? To choose. So therefore the responsibility actually came back to who? God. And God took the responsibility. And this is the reason why God had to become man. And the way that he was born, he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. So therefore, he would be able to identify with mankind on every level. Amen. He knows us better than anybody else.
Pastor, this is funny, because I kept, every time you said reality, you did the reality before. I kept thinking to myself, there's a lot of things that I know that's available, but it's really not my reality. So when you start, just a second ago, man, I don't know how, it was so profound what you just said, that God operated legally. And so we can say these scriptures, and if you don't know the law, it's not your reality. Though it may be something that you possess, is not your reality, you know. And so without the meditation, you never know law. You follow what I'm saying? And so I wanted to say that because the redemptive part is more of a reality in the spirit realm. Because your spirit is truth, you know what I'm saying? But the soulish realm is where we kind of we miss it, you know. And so help. I said that because maybe you can help me or help us, you know, be able to develop the soulish man to to grab hold of the redemptive reality that our spirit should walk in liberty, you know, on earth.
That's good. Okay, in order, anybody want to respond to that?
Well, I would.
That's deep. It is deep.
Knowing that the spirit realm is, we've been justified in the spirit realm, but our natural man, which is our soul and the thinking and everything we learn from whenever, it competes against the truth of it that's in the spirit world. So you have to determine in your soulish man, which way am I going to go? And that's where he's made us free will agents as to you decide which way you're going to be governed by. By the spirit realm or by what you feel, see, hear, everything else has been thrown into your soulish realm.
What does that word govern? I say that because I'm trying to
control by. This is the
what law are you going to abide by?
That's the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. And you have to, and you say anything outside, anything contrary to that law of life is going to put you back to where we're reading in Hebrews, subject to bondage.
Oh, that's deep. Oh, that's good.
All right, so I think that the meditation aspect of how the redemptive work and actually acting on what the word says, that's the thing that actually makes everything reality. You know, faith works by what?
Love.
So in order for any of this to become reality, it requires a renewing of the mind, and the Bible mentions about be not what conformed to this world, but be thou what?
Transformed
by the what?
Renewing of the mind.
By renewing of the mind, so that you may what? Prove that which is what?
Yes.
Good, what else?
Acceptable.
And what else?
Pure.
Perfect will of God. So actually, when we begin to walk out our righteousness, the works of righteousness, the Bible says, increase the fruit of your righteousness. And when you begin to walk that out and do what Jesus has called us to do in terms of, you know, following him and doing the same works that he did, I think that all of this will begin to unfold and really become reality to all of us. But I think it starts with meditation. And I think that this is something that we need to give our lives more over to the meditation of the Word of God, especially the aspect of the Word that deals with our redemptive work. So I think that that's when that becomes reality to us. All right, so let's move further. Hebrews 2, and I believe Hebrews 2, 9, it mentions about, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and what? Honor. That he, by the grace of God, should taste death for what?
Every man.
All right, so Jesus has tasted death. Okay, are we talking about physical death or spiritual death?
All right.
The word death is plural, so he died first. He died first spiritually or physically?
Spiritually, he died first.
Right.
Separated.
Visually, spiritually.
He died spiritually.
Everybody understand that Jesus died first what?
Spiritually.
All right. He died spiritually first because he couldn't die physically, right? Until he died spiritually. Is that right, everybody?
Yes.
Okay? So all of that suffering that we explained Sunday, we explained Wednesday night, that was an account of his what? Spiritual suffering, right? Which was very grievous, it was very intense, it was full of agony, and that's how the sufferings of Christ led to the birth of the new creation. I mean, the birth arose of his suffering during that 3-day period is the thing that led to our redemption. That's how we were freed and delivered down while Christ was travailing with our sins. Okay, now the second aspect of our redemptive work, we deal with Christ being made alive. What is that speaking about?
That's when he was made alive.
Christ being made alive. All right, he suffered until he was what? Made alive. Can anybody explain that? He suffered until he was made alive. Until he was quickened.
He had fully paid the price for redeeming mankind, which was the penalty of sin. And once that was paid in full, satisfied God, and then God quickened him or made him alive again.
All right, everybody understand that. Christ was made alive after the Bible says he was delivered up for our offenses, and he was raised again when we were legally justified. In other words, when the price had been paid fully for our what? Righteousness to become reality. Everybody follow that?
Yeah.
When the price was paid in full for our righteousness to be restored, you know, and down in hell, we weren't righteous down there, but we can identify with him. We were made, actually, in the mind of God, we were made righteous there when he was made righteous. Right? But actually, the redemptive process was not complete until Jesus actually what? Sat down. Is that right?
Yeah.
Until he sat down, because he had to seal our redemption with his what? Blood. He entered into the Holy of Holiness, Holy of Holies, and presented his blood on the covenant, on the seal of seal our redemption with his blood. So that was when it was complete. And Jesus sat down, and then it was possible on legal ground for Jesus to give, to extend eternal life to everyone that would take him as what? Lord and Savior. Mm-hmm. Amen. It was the process was complete. All right, so Jesus was quickened, he was made alive, and let's turn to that scripture again. And give me a scripture that shows that we identified with Christ when he was made alive. Give us a scripture that will show us that we identify with him when he was made alive.
How about Colossians? Colossians. Colossians 1:13-14.
What does that say?
Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin.
Okay. Is there another one that somebody else can read?
Set your question again.
Okay, I want a scripture that shows how we relate to him being dead in sins and trespasses. We were quickened together with him. We plan of God, we were made alive.
Mine is the Ephesians prayer sign, because we started at 17, and God, like God, our Lord Jesus Christ, Father, brother, give unto you spirit of wisdom, revelation, and knowledge of Him. The eyes of your understanding and light that you may know what is over your calling, and what is the riches of the glory and the inheritance of the saints, and what is His exceeding greatness of His power in what us were, who believe according to the work of His mighty power, which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and set Him on His own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principalities, powers, might, dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and have put all things under His feet, and gave Him to be the head of all things to the church, that's us, which is His body. The church is us, which is His body. He's the head, we the body. The fullness of Him that filleth all in all.
Okay, good.
How about 1 Corinthians 1 and 30?
Yeah.
Are you made? Okay. Christ has been made unto us.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's good. The one that I had in mind is Ephesians 2.
I was about to
say. Even when we were dead in sins, and quickened us together with Christ, by grace you're saved. And have raised us up together and made us what?
Sit together in
heavenly places
in
Christ Jesus. So that shows that we identify with Christ in every aspect of His what? His redemption. When He died, we were in the mind of God, you know, it was for us. Right? We were the object of Christ's what? Redemption. Did God need this redemption for Himself?
No.
Did Christ need it for Himself?
No.
All right, so the object of the redemptive work of Christ was for what?
Us.
He was our substitute. So in every aspect of His redemptive work, it was some way that Christ was what? He was being a substitute what? For us. He was redeeming us. The scripture says He has redeemed us from the what? All right, let's say it again. He has redeemed us from what? All right. Sister Hill read the scripture. He has delivered us from the what?
Power of darkness.
From the power of what?
Darkness. Translate.
Let's say it again. From the what?
Power of darkness.
All right. Everybody said that He has what?
Deliver us from the power of darkness.
All right, so these are things that we need to articulate if we ever want these things to become reality, to the extent that we can begin to what? Act on them and make them reality, then we need to really begin to what? We need to confess them. And how difficult it is for us to get the revelation of the importance of us confessing all of these realities. If He has delivered us, we need to what? We need to. All right? How often do we hear these confessions?
Should hear them every day, all day.
All right? How often should we hear them? How often do we hear them, actually hear them?
I hear them all day.
What I mean that among ourselves in prayer and we need to what? Really need to begin to
express.
Okay. How important it is for us to affirm these things?
Very.
All right. How important is it?
Very.
All right, everybody say very important.
Yeah.
All right, so we want to make a point in consistently confessing the realities. And if they're going to become realities, they will have to be what? Consistently what? Confessed.
Amen.
All right, the heart of the wise will teach his what? Mouth. All right, turn to that scripture, Proverbs 16:23. The heart of the wise will teach his mouth. So our mouth needs to be what? Trained. Amen. To consistently agree with the things that God has what? Said about us.
What scripture is that, Pastor?
Proverbs 16:23. I read it right?
Yes.
The heart of the wise teaches his what?
Mouth
and what?
And learning to his ears.
All right, can anybody explain that, expound on that? The heart of the wise teaches his mouth.
You substitute heart with mind, you say the mind of the wise teaches his mouth.
I would say the heart, there is the spirit man. Mm-hmm. The spirit, which is the born-again spirit, is teaching, trying to get it to us. And then once we learn from what we learn from that spirit man, we put it on the mouth, then deliverance is manifested. Romans 10:9-10, same thing. You got to have it in your heart, you have to roll it off your mouth, and then it becomes a reality.
All right, so how do we get it in our heart?
Meditate
what's in the heart.
All right, so
if you're not comprehending it in the mind, then it's not going to be able to be displayed in your lips.
It's still in the heart.
It's internally in our hearts.
Yeah.
But the disconnect is not where our mind is able to perceive it into reality.
Well, that's why I go to your mouth. See, faith come by.
But your heart is not teaching your mind to say what's on your lips. Your mind says, your mind speaks through your lips, not your heart.
Well, that's what...
No, I mean, without understanding.
To understand the heart.
The mouth speaks. So that's why I say substitute heart for mind.
No, that's what we disagree.
Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks.
Now you have to define heart.
Heart.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Heart is the core.
That's spirit.
Yeah. You have to say spirit.
Yeah. What was interesting is that when you speak out of here, it's something that we even talked about Monday. Out of the belly will flow the rivers of life. So it'll flow out of here will flow life. And so you have to train your mouth to be able to flow with the spirit. Now once you do that, then your mind catch up with the heart. It catch up with the... And when you got it backwards, it's hard for you to comprehend. But you got to come from the inner man. This word comes from the inner man.
Well, I think we're saying the same thing, only I'm saying your spirit has to connect with your mind to be able to speak.
And we saying that happens through the mouth. That's why the enemy wants you to keep your mouth shut.
But that's what I'm saying. Exactly. That's why you can't speak unless your spirit speaks through your mind to speak the word.
Okay. Well, I can understand that human.
I mean, you have to understand what you're speaking.
Well, that's what we said. Understanding.
Right. You have to understand.
That's why a lot of people don't pray in tongues.
Right.
That's true.
Because
that's true.
The spirit is very, very active and alive. But wait a minute, I gotta get my mind on this thing.
That's why the word tells you you gotta renew your mind.
You have to renew your mind. But you do that through speaking.
It's through the spirit.
No.
That's how you renew your mind, is through your spirit.
But it's twofold. It's like you can't drive without gas.
I don't think you're renewing your mind. That's what's renews in your mind, as your spirit.
Okay, now the process of faith starts with you speaking of your mouth, right?
Right.
Okay. Usually the first way that we express faith is by what?
Here.
By confession.
Confession.
That's right. So you have to feed your heart faith with your mouth. Right? Alright? And sometimes that's a process.
Yeah.
Because immediately your heart is not gonna be what? Infused to the extent where you are going what? To be alive enough to act in faith. So therefore you're gonna have to keep speaking. That's the reason why the scripture says this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth.
Yeah.
But thou shalt meditate. Meditate means to what? To speak it, to use it, and to speak out loud. So you have to speak it until your heart.
It's not sensible.
Mm-hmm.
Until you start believing.
Yeah, until you start believing. All right, so faith comes, you gotta feed your heart. You feed your heart faith with your mouth. And then when your heart gets impregnated, infused with the word, then it can what? Teach your mouth. And that's when you really begin ABCs. Mm-hmm. All right, did you get it? Was that in your subconscious mind to start with? I know some But we fed our what subconscious with our what mouth. Nine times eight. We said it over and over and over and over until what our subconscious got it.
Right, exactly.
And now you don't even have to think. You can just say 9 times 12. I mean, you know, just like that, right?
24 says,
yes.
Verse 24 says, pleasant words are as honeycomb, sweet to the soul. That's inclusive of the mind. And health to the what?
Yeah.
Health to the bones.
Yeah, that's good.
So, Pastor, is that when people back at, years ago, they kept saying, fake it till you make it? In other words, you still was basing it on the word. Mm-hmm. You just kept repeating and believing it until it was manifested.
Mm-hmm.
So, is that, I know some people got confused about that. And I don't totally agree with everything about that, but I think that's what. The good part of it was they were saying, if you just keep believing because it's the word, if it's in the word, it's so. Mm-hmm. So you just keep on believing, keep on walking in it until it's manifested or until it's made real to you.
Mm-hmm.
And I know for myself, even something I know is word, I know it's true, mm-hmm. I won't deny it, mm-hmm. but all of a sudden one day it became alive to me.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I know sometimes we think we're walking in faith
mm-hmm.
and we just walking mm-hmm. in like the robots. Because we know that's what we're supposed to do. We know that's what the word says.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still not alive to us until mm-hmm. it becomes alive. And you'd be like, okay, here it is, you know. Mm-hmm.
You know how God told Abraham something very outlandish?
Mm-hmm.
Abraham had to keep saying mm-hmm. what he heard the Spirit say to
mm-hmm.
him before it became a reality.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, he had to keep, my name is no longer Abram. I'm Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
And you no longer Sarah. So, and that was kind of, it took a long time for him for him feed himself what he heard.
Mm-hmm.
He had to say it, and then it became real, it became alive.
Mm-hmm.
But the Spirit is always talking to us.
Mm-hmm.
The law of the Spirit
is
always giving it to us.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to watch out that we don't override. And the best place for that override to happen is in the mind.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's best to get it from the Spirit and say it.
Yeah.
And I don't understand it. I don't comprehend it. I don't make no sense. But if it's the word and I say it,
mm-hmm.
and saying it makes me hear it,
mm-hmm.
faith comes from that.
Right.
So It is a process. It's sometimes some people can hear it the first time. Bam, got it. Mm-hmm. My way.
So we just get trained by repeating something. What are you training when you do that?
You're training your mind.
Mm-hmm. Your mind.
Because your mind will overrule everything.
That's right. True.
So you're getting your mind to agree with the spirit.
Yeah.
That's why I read that scripture.
It said,
getting your mind to agree with the spirit.
Yeah.
But I'm saying until you get that mind comprehending what the spirit is saying, it's not going to work.
He'll tell me stuff.
Well, sometimes the mind, you don't need the mind. I don't mean to interrupt. Sometimes it's best not to have the mind.
But sometimes he'll tell me something. And I know that was my spirit. And then he'll almost say, like, yes, I said that. I mean, that's lovely. And I'd be like, okay.
I mean, told Peter to come out on that water. It didn't make no sense.
No, it makes sense
to his mind.
And he jumped out there, though.
He just said, okay. Right. Here I go. It never did make sense. Walking on water.
Still. Okay, look here. Here are some meditations I think it would be good for y'all to check on. A man's belly shall be satisfied with the foot of his mouth.
What scripture are you reading?
It's Proverbs 18:21.
Proverbs 18.
A man's belly shall be satisfied with the foot of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. Death and life is in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Okay, that's Proverbs 18. All of these are in the meditations under Speak Out God's Word, the importance of speaking out God's Word. It says, the mouth of the upright shall deliver them. The mouth of the upright shall deliver them. Isaiah 57:19, I create the fruit of the lips. I create the fruit of the lips. I like this one, Proverbs 12:25. Heaviness in the heart maketh it stoop, but a good word maketh it glad. These are scriptures that shows the importance of your mouth staying in agreement with God's word, so that your spirit man can become impregnated to the extent where the word of God will become reality. 2 Corinthians, well, all of these scriptures are scriptures that we consistently admonish you to read. We have in the same spirit of faith according as it is written. I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore what?
Speak.
And Philemon 1:6, the communication of thy faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. And that was the motivation that I started earlier focusing on. If we really want to become devil masters, if we want to actually to see all of these realities of who we are in Christ actually to become real to us, I think it begins with what? Speaking them with our mouths until our spirits becomes what? Impregnated with the power and the anointing of God. So we have to really begin to use our mouths, and many times we like to use our mouths.
Yeah.
How many like to use your mouth?
Depends on what you're using it for.
Okay, now this is a whole section on meditation. It shows the importance of us speaking the word in order to get the word into our spirit. And these are new creation realities as well. And the new creation realities are on page, we need to see what page they are on. I think the spiritual things that we are needing. Page 88 through 121, 120 something. Our release from Satan's power. Our release. Somebody tell me why it's important for us to begin to speak that. Speak our release. Begin to affirm our release from Satan's power.
Well, it's necessary in order for us to walk in authority.
And we don't affirm it, we'll never have the victory.
You never have it.
All right. Is that important? In order for us to get free from satanic dominion, even after we are born again? Because all of it don't happen when we are what? Filled with the Holy Ghost, right?
That's right.
Okay, we're going to have to continue to what? To speak these things in order for these things to become what?
Manifested
in our lives. So, I know when we were going to Rhema that this was a part of the teaching that it seemed like Brother Hagin could never get over. He said, getting people to speak, to keep the word of God in their, they don't have any problem believing. That's what he was saying. It's easier to believe because believing just comes from an accumulation of knowledge. But to get people to confess, to consistently stay in agreement with God's word, that's going to be the biggest challenge that all of us are going to have. Because sometimes we just don't feel like we want to what? Open up our mouths and what? Place ourselves in agreement by what? Affirming what God has what? Clearly said. That's going to be our biggest challenge. And I think it's one of the biggest hindrances in prayer, because many times in prayer, it could be a lot more deliverance. It could be a whole lot more release. It could be a whole lot of what? Fulfillment and manifestation and even gifts of the Spirit if we would combine. I think the praise and worship is fine too. I think that we need to do both. I think we need to what? Confess the word, and I think that we need to what? Praise God for the things that we are what? Believing for. So I think that if we could praise God as well as what? Keep the word of God. I think that when we are ministering to each other, when we are praying with each other, I think all kind of stuff ought to be coming out of our mouth.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's the thing that what? That's the thing that really builds people up. You know, if you do it all in the spirit, all in tongues, you don't get the benefit of what? Of speaking to yourselves and what? Hymns, psalms, hymns, and what? Spiritual songs. So I think that we need to pray in the spirit, but we need to what? Confess the word of God as we pray. And then praise God for whatever you are what? Confessing. Praise God for it. Amen. I don't know whether we'll ever get this over to the saints.
I heard Brother Hagin say it like this. He said, you know, sometimes Christians, we'll pray, without the word. He said prayer, he liked to liken to breathing and eating. He said, now, if you breathe and you ain't had nothing to eat, you eventually gonna die. You follow what I'm saying? He said, no, the word is that what you need to eat, and you need to speak. Mm-hmm. And so, and then he said, if you just got food, but you ain't breathing, you gonna die. And so I think we need, like you said, we need both, you know, in order to have spiritual life.
Mm-hmm. All right, everything went dead on us. Everything goes dead when you start talking about me opening my mouth and saying stuff. I think sometimes people feel that I don't know what to say. I might say the wrong thing. I'm not familiar enough with what I want to say to what? To verbalize it. Maybe y'all can give us some input on that, because I think that we need some help in our prayer meetings in terms of us agreeing with God you know, all of these realities, I mean, there's a thousand of them that we can say.
I think sometimes we try to pray out of the flesh. And so when you try to do that, you're praying out of something that's corrupted. And so when we do that, yeah, your flesh don't want to say nothing. If I won't say,
if you see yourself as Adam before he failed, and you have to understand that Adam had to fellowship with God. Yeah. So what will happen, we have to get in the Word and fellowship with God. And that's why Adam learned everything from his fellowship with the Word, which was God, and the Word was God. That's what Adam did. He got in there. And once he was in there, how awesome was he as a man?
Yeah.
Or he, you know, did some awesome things until he transgressed. So, you know, we have to see, we're not going to be, if we've been brought back to where Adam was, then we've got to take the same path. It's, okay. It's available, so available to us. But if you don't, you know, Adam had to speak. Can't okay. Speak up.
All right, that's good. Let's do the second Adam. That's because he actually records his confession. Jesus' bold declaration concerning himself. Page 86. Anybody have the regular book?
Yes.
This is the path of spiritual breakthrough. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, this is what Jesus said. The queen of the south shall rise up in the judgment with this generation and shall condemn it. For she came from the uttermost parts of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. Mm-hmm. And this is what Jesus said, and behold, a greater than Solomon is here. Now Jesus said that about himself.
Yeah.
That was bold, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, if Jesus said it, that means it's all right for us to what? Say it.
As speaking as a man like that, I know someone looked at him like he was crazy.
They do that to me and everybody else.
Those that didn't believe, you know.
All of these confessions are recorded that Jesus made during his earthly ministry are recorded on 86 and 87. Several of them are recorded. So this is a good example for all of us to follow. Jesus felt comfortable in articulating who he was. I am the bread of life. I am the resurrection. I'm the life. I'm the good shepherd. All of these scriptures. I am the true man and my father is the husbandman. I came forth from the Father and am coming to the world. Again, I leave the world. I go to my Father. I mean, he had confessions after confessions and declarations after declarations. So Jesus was the one that gives us the example of how important it is for us to what? To speak out what the Father says about us, who we are, whatever Christ has made us and he has done for us, these things we ought to consistently what? Acknowledge. Is that right, Sister Hill?
That's right. All right. Amen.
All right. All right. After we acknowledge them, then we can what? Praise God for them. And thank God. Pray in the Spirit over them. But I think it's important for us to what? Acknowledge them. And I think it's really important for saints to hear each other. Because this is how we build ourselves up. I mean, it could be all types of edification going on here.
Yeah.
If the saints could get the revelation, how important for you to take your place in what? Speaking out what God what says about you. As he is, so am I. Amen. Through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, what? We reign in this life. I mean, you know, scripture after scripture after scripture after scripture attest to the realities that Christ has what? Given us, and if we agree with them and affirm them, they will become realities to us. Praise God. Well, I'm not going to let nobody shut me down.
Yeah.
Glory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Y'all can keep quiet if y'all want to. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah.
Sometimes we don't know whether we agree or not because we don't know what he's saying. You got to avail yourself to the word to be able to confess the word. You got to take that time to read the word and meditate
that's
on
true.
It. Yeah. To put yourself in a situation where you hear this kind of word. Surround yourself by people who are speaking the word.
All right. Well, Sister Candace said that we might need to pull out our Bibles or meditation books and start what? Finding out what's in here.
And to piggyback on that, what she said, I'd like to reflect on something Brother Wayne said Monday night, is that sometimes, you know, we do meditate, we do reflect, but we may come just a little short of going, pressing beyond, to keep continuing to do it. We have to continue in his way. Sometimes, you know, we may get tired and just quit and stop. Like he was saying, we praise the Lord, but like on Sundays, he said, we need to enter into worship. So if we stop at just the praise, then we're not going to get all that's available to us. You know, we have to press and continue to press and press. And you know, sometimes physically or mentally you don't want to do that. So that means that we shortchange ourselves if we don't press and keep pressing. And keep pressing.
All right, well, let's all stand.
Father, tonight we thank you for a revelation of how important it is for us to speak your word and to stay in agreement and to consistently affirm all of the things that you have made us through your redemptive work. Lord, we are the righteousness of God. You have become our wisdom. Yes, you have become our redemption. You have become our sanctification. And you have become our righteousness. Oh God, we thank you. Glory. That greater are you that is in us than he that is in the world. And Father, if you be for us, it doesn't matter who's against us. And we thank you, Lord, that it, hallelujah, that goodness and mercy shall follow me
all
the days of my life. You are my shepherd, and I shall not want. Your grace is sufficient for me.
Yes.
I am what I am because of the grace of God. If you be for me, it doesn't matter who is against me. Satan is defeated.
Yes.
I've been delivered from the power of darkness.
Yes.
He has no right to lord it over me at all. Hallelujah. Bind Satan on every hand. Pull down the stronghold. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty.
Hallelujah.
Hey, mighty through God in the pulling down of strongholds. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the word of God. We can pull down the strongholds of the enemy. Thank you for the name of Jesus, because it's the name above every name. We thank you, God, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus makes me free. Hey, and he the Son set free shall be free, and free indeed. Father, thank you that I stand fast in that liberty wherewith Christ has made me free. And I will not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Father, we thank you tonight for the victory, for this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Father, we thank you tonight. In Jesus' name, may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now, henceforth, and forever. Everybody said together, praise the Lord. Thank God for the victory tonight. Thank God for the victory.
Amen.
Hallelujah.